Hello children, welcome back. We have finished the first chapter, Fundamental Unit of Life, and last time I had given you a questionnaire covering the important concepts of the chapter. I hope you all have solved the assignment. Please go through all the videos, try to recall the concepts, recapitulate, and I'm sure you'll be able to understand. Right? So let us proceed further with the syllabus. Today I am about to begin a new chapter after Fundamental Unit of Life, that is tissues. Children, we had learned that cell is the structural and functional unit. We called it the structural unit of life because cells assemble to form tissues, tissues assemble to form organ and organ systems, right? So we have learned the tiniest part, fundamental unit, and now we are about to learn tissues, a second level of complexity. That is, whenever you have a collection of similar cells which are similar in function and origin and structure, then that collection of a cell is called a tissue. So the very first thing you should know in this chapter is that what is the definition of a tissue? A tissue can be defined as a group or collection of similar cells or dissimilar cells that perform or help to perform a common function and have a common origin. In a very simplified form, you can say that a tissue is a group or collection of cells which are similar in structure, origin, and function. Children, have a look at this diagram. You can see different types of tissues. See, this is a tissue because it contains similar looking cells which are similar in structure, origin, and function. Even this is a tissue. It has similar cells, okay, similar in structure, origin, and function. Even this is a tissue, right? So you can say, children, that a body, be it a plant body or an animal body, comprises of several tissues in the body, because all tissues are not of the same shape, structure, or function. There is a collection of several tissues depending upon the complexity of the plant body or the animal body, because we had stated earlier that every plant or animal or any living organism will exhibit division of labor. There will be distribution of work. So even in a single cell, when there was division of labor in the form of tiny organelles performing different functions, so obviously different tissues in the body will perform different functions. So for that purpose, we are learning this chapter in detail. We will be learning types of plant tissues and animal tissues. So let us proceed further. Since you are now aware of the definition of tissue, let us move ahead. Tissues can be broadly classified into plant tissues and animal tissues. Now, first of all, before we begin plant tissues and animal tissues, we should understand that there are noticeable differences between plant and animal tissues, because plants are structurally very different from animals. So obviously there will be a difference in the tissues as well. Let us see what are the striking differences between plants and animals and why are there differences in the tissues. The first and foremost point is that plant tissues are comparatively less complex because they are less complex in structure, whereas animals have organ systems in their body, right? So obviously the tissues forming organs and organ systems will be relatively more complex. Second difference is that plants, children, they are stationary. They have a sedentary existence. So if they are sedentary, they cannot move from one place to another, then their energy requirements are very less. Apart from that, they need more support, strength, and rigidity because they have to withstand all kind of environmental stress staying at one position. So the tissues are also designed accordingly. Plants have both living cells as well as dead cells in the tissues. A living tissue will comprise of living cells, a dead tissue will comprise of dead cells. More the amount of dead tissue, more is the strength and rigidity. So plants will have both kinds of tissues, but animals, they show movement, they show locomotion, their energy requirements are more because they have to move in search of food, shelter, mates, etc. So they need more energy. So obviously the tissues are living in nature. They do not possess any dead tissue. Now, the third important point is, which is very important, children, that in plants, growth does not take place everywhere in the plant body. It is localized to certain regions of the plant only. So you can say there are specific regions in the plant only where growth takes place. And this growth takes place in an indefinite manner throughout the lifetime in those regions. But on the contrary, animals, they have a definite and uniform pattern of growth. It takes place uniformly throughout the body. It does not happen one part is growing and the other part is not growing. So in animals, there is growth taking place for a certain time period and it is uniform throughout the animal body. So these are the striking differences between plant tissues and animal tissues. A very important question as far as exam point of view is concerned. Now let us proceed towards plant tissues. Children, plant tissues can be broadly classified into meristematic tissues and permanent tissues. As I said, plant will have two types of tissues, living as well as dead. So wherever you have a living tissue, that is the meristematic tissue, and that meristematic tissue cells, okay, will have the ability of cell division. If a cell is able to divide and produce more number of cells, obviously, with the increase in number, growth will take place in that particular plant part. Right? So meristematic tissues are the first kind of plant tissues, which are the dividing tissues, where the cells have the ability of cell division and they will be responsible for growth in the plant part. On the contrary, permanent tissues will show only a specific function, that is, they will be permanent in the plant body, but they do not have the ability of cell division. So they will take up a specific function and become permanent, but they will not be responsible for growth in any part of the plant. So one by one, we will take up meristematic tissues and then we will take up permanent tissues. So first, let us begin with meristematic tissue. We will be learning three types of meristematic tissues: apical meristem, intercalary meristem, and lateral meristem. Okay, now before we learn the types, let us see what is a meristematic tissue. Meristematic tissue is the kind of tissue which is a collection of living cells that has the ability to divide, add new cells, and hence they will be responsible for the growth. Okay, children? Now, to understand the cells, we should first understand the structure of the meristematic cells. If you see the cells of the meristematic tissue, they are roughly oval or polygonal in shape. They are tightly packed. They do not have intercellular spaces in between. You can see that there are no spaces in between the cells. They have thin cell walls made up of cellulose. They have a dense cytoplasm and a prominent nucleus. Children, these are all plant cells, and we expect that plant cells have vacuoles. But meristematic cells, they lack vacuoles. Reason behind, these are the living cells which are going to help in growth. So they will continuously divide to increase the number. Since they are in an active state of division, their function is not food storage. That is why they lack vacuoles. Okay, so this is the structure of the meristematic cells. Let us see the characteristics of these cells. Cells have a thin cell wall made up of cellulose. They are round, polygonal in shape, compactly arranged. They have a dense cytoplasm and prominent nucleus, and cells, they lack vacuoles because they are in a continuous state of division. Okay, now children, these were the characteristics of the cells forming the meristematic tissue. Let us now understand the types of meristematic tissue. For that, you have to understand the location of these tissues in the plant body. Children, have a look at this diagram. This diagram is also given in your NCRT. It is the schematic representation showing the position of different types of meristematic tissues or meristems in the plant body. Consider this diagram. This is a plant body. It is a shoot, okay, the part of the plant that grows above the soil. You can see, children, that the first type of meristematic tissue is the apical meristematic tissue. The apical meristematic tissue is located on the apex of the shoot. Apex means the vertex or the pointed region. The pointed region of the shoot, the pointed region of the branches, and even the pointed region of the roots. Let us say this is the root which is growing beneath the soil, and these are the root hairs coming out. Okay. Now, on the tips of the root, the tips of the root hairs, this tissue will be present. So, that is why the name given is apical meristematic tissue. Now, the cells or the tissues present over here, when they will divide and increase, they will increase the length of the root tip. They will increase the length of this branch on the tip. They will increase the length of the root tip and the root hairs. So basically, as I said, they will be responsible for growth. So when there is division of the cells of the apical meristematic tissue, it leads to longitudinal growth of the root tip and the shoot tips or the branches. Okay, the second type of meristematic tissue is the intercalary meristematic tissue. Now, this type of tissue, it is present in the node region and the internode region of the plant. What is a node? A node is the region from where a branch or a leaf will emerge in the stem. See, this is also one node, this is node, this is node, this is node, right? And the region between two nodes, this is one node, this is another node. The region between two nodes is called the internode region. So the kind of meristematic tissue which is present at the base of the node or in between the internodes, when there is division in the cells of this particular meristematic tissue, it leads to increase in the length of the organ. Okay, this is also responsible for linear growth. Okay, apical meristematic tissue will increase in the tip. The length of the organ or the branches from the backside will be responsible due to division of the intercalary meristematic tissue. And the third type is the lateral meristematic tissue. This type of tissue is generally present on the sides of the stem as well as the root. And because it is present on the edges, there is a particular plane of division. When the cells of this lateral meristematic tissue, they will divide. They will divide in this particular plane. And when they divide and increase the number, it will lead to increase in the thickness of the stem. It will increase the girth or the diameter of the stem or the root or the branch. So you can see, children, there will be growth taking place in the tips, in between, that is the nodes and the internode, as well as on the sides. So the linear growth is attributed to the growth in apical and intercalary meristematic tissue, whereas the girth or the diameter or the thickness is attributed to the lateral meristematic tissue. So children, this diagram is important. It shows the location of the different meristematic tissues. Okay, so these are the three types of meristematic tissues. The first one is the apical meristematic tissue present in the root and the shoot tips. Second one is the intercalary present at the base of the nodes and in the internode, which leads to vertical growth and increase in the length of the organ. And the third type is the lateral meristematic tissue, which is present on the sides, and this tissue division leads to increase in the diameter or the thickness or the girth of the plants. Okay, so this finishes your meristematic tissue, and now we proceed towards the permanent tissue. The second type of tissue where the cells do not have the ability of cell division is called permanent tissue. Now, from where does this tissue come? This tissue is derived from the differentiation of the meristematic tissue. Differentiation means what? It refers to the process where cells of the meristematic tissue, that is the dividing tissue, they lose their ability to divide after certain time, and when they lose their ability to divide, they take up a specific function and become permanent in the plant body. So you can say that permanent tissue is derived from the differentiation of the meristematic tissue, and it is not responsible for growth. In my next class, I will teach you types of permanent tissues. So for today, we have learned types of meristematic tissues. We have learned the characteristics of meristematic tissues, and we have learned the location of the types of meristematic tissues in the plant body. So that is all for today. Thank you and have a nice day.